hear a word from you. It is our prayer that my voice is only the sound that is used, that they may hear exactly what you have for them on this Pentecost Sunday. That we are reminded that as the Holy Spirit fell in the room and allowed us to join with the disciples in the great work that you have for us, that you endow each of us with the call to make the world a better place. And so be with us in this moment. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
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 For a moment, can we imagine that we are approaching our 50th birthday? For some of us, we may have to rewind the clock a little bit. For others of us, we may have to fast forward the clock a little bit. But just for a moment, let us imagine that we are about to turn 50 years old. As a matter of fact, for all intent and purposes, we are like Zach. Where's Zach? We're like Zach this morning. We just graduated high school. We are at the brink of adulthood. We are closing one chapter in our lives, and we are preparing to write a few more in our book. And for some of us, like Zach, college is in our near future. And we've submitted our test scores, we've submitted our applications, and we've been accepted to the school of our choice, or perhaps the school that gave us the most money. We have already mapped out what courses we're going to take, and we kind of pondered what major or what minor we're going to operate in. And, you know, we may assume that once we graduate college, there's this dream job waiting on us where we'll be making lots of money. And perhaps while in college, we found the love of our lives, that special someone to share the rest of our lives with. Or maybe we didn't decide to go to college. Maybe we decided to go to the military or some other active service toward our country. We have been tested and we've been trained, awaiting transportation or to be transported to basic training. Our eagerness to serve our country in whatever ways has us so excited, whether that be domestically or abroad. And like our college counterparts, we may have found that love of our lives to share with, to travel with, to build and to start a family. Yet, still, there is a remnant of us who says, you know what, I'm going to take another route. I'm not going to college, I'm not going into the military. I'm probably just going to enter the workforce in a variety of trades, electrician, retail, salesman, or other. Instead of wasting time, we're just going to capitalize on our youth, and we're going to travel the world, maybe go backpacking across Europe or something or another. We don't foresee building a family, nor do we want one. We're just going to live single, young, wild, and free. And so all of that has happened, and now we are approaching 50 years old. Now, for some of y'all who had to rewind the clock back, let's just imagine that you don't know what's ahead. You don't know what's ahead of 50. When we get to that point in our life, can we ask ourselves this question? What has our life been like up to this point? Does our family look the way we thought it would look? Are we as successful as we thought we would be? And most importantly, are we living according to the calling we believe God has placed in our lives? See, I believe the scripture that we have heard this morning and that I'm going to read again gives us a little insight into the intentionality of Paul's ministry. Hear these words again. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind, straining forward to what lies ahead, I press toward the goal of the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. Now, for as much as we know, Paul was writing this letter, and it was written to the church at Philippi, which is identified as the first Christian church in Europe. And as much as we know, this could have been Paul's first letter, because Paul was incarcerated at the beginning of his ministry at Corinth. However, this could have also been one of Paul's later letters when he was incarcerated in Rome. Why is this important? Well, I'm glad y'all asked. This is important to us because I believe Philippians reveals to us that regardless of the age we are, and regardless of the stage in life we are, whether we're young or whether we're old, whether we're at the beginning of our careers or whether we're at the end of our careers, what's most important is that we should continue to press toward the call that Jesus has equipped each of us for. Can you do me a favor? I want everyone to participate in this sermon and turn to somebody close to you and ask them, are you pressing toward God's call?
Pressing towards God's call?
Now respond to that person and say, whatever you do, whatever you do,
whatever you do,
don't stop pressing.
Don't stop pressing.
So, what is this call that I'm talking about? And how do we identify it? Once again, I'm glad you asked. When I was growing up in Dallas, I had no idea that I would be a pastor. When I was growing up, this position, doing this, was nowhere close to my mind. I actually wanted to be a defense attorney. I had witnessed so many people in my neighborhood falsely accused of crimes or offenses that they were innocent of, including myself, that I figured there was no better way to right a wrong that I saw happening so frequently. I was accepted into a magnet program which focused on humanities, law, sociology, psychology. I had my sights on Georgetown University in Washington, D.C. One, because I was much slimmer in my high school days, and I was going to play basketball for the great John Thompson. But also because they had the best law program in the nation. But I never made it to Georgetown. However, I would go to D.C. much later in my life. I ended up majoring in business management with a minor in marketing instead of law. In 2 years before I was to graduate, a shift happened in my life. I heard God speak to me for the first time, June 12, 2005. I wasn't at church, but it was a Sunday. I decided that day that I would set out to see what God had for me. It was also the day that I decided to develop a relationship with God that will reveal to me, how much God loves the world, and God wants to use me to make this world a better place. It was that day I answered the call. Now, I'll spare you much of those details of what happened between June 12th and where I am today. But one thing I am glad this morning is that I'm a United Methodist pastor. And one of the reasons why I'm glad, even though I will say this, and Pastor Darling can attest to this, the process to become a United Methodist pastor is arduous, to say the least. For those who like, that's an SAT word, but why are you using that? It can be hard. And no other time reminded me than recently when I stood before my own Sanhedrin council called the Board of Ordained Ministry. And I had to stand before them and talk. But the reason why I really enjoy being a United Methodist pastor is because each stage of that journey allows me to share my call story. It allows me to share the moment a wayward young kid from Dallas heard God's voice. It allows me to share with them how the dreams I had of going in business and making a lot of money was derailed by God so that I can save as many people as possible and glorify God. I get to share with them that I had dreams to go this way, and God stepped in and put me on a different path. And I'm so glad to be able to share that call. Because that call, regardless of all the other things that we have to do, is what identifies us with to be the change agents God desires for us in this world. Now, I believe one of the biggest misconceptions of Christianity, young people, hear me clearly, and you'll probably feel this way too. I believe one of the biggest misconceptions of Christianity is the idea that Christianity is a bunch of rules. It's a bunch of a list of do's and don'ts in order to win God's approval. This couldn't be further from the truth. And here's why. The religious leaders of Jesus' day constantly accused Jesus of disobeying and teaching disobedience to God's law. And Jesus responds to them this way. I did not come to abolish the law, but I came to fulfill the law. Or in other words, I did not come to change the rules of the game, I just came to make the game fair for everybody who's playing. This is the call I believe each of us has, and what it means to respond to the call of God in Christ Jesus. When we operate according to our call, our purpose for living, the urge, the desire, the deep-seated tugging that is in our hearts to change the world for the better, we're operating according to the call of God. I realize that it's not about how much money we can make. It's not about how successful we can be according to societal standards. I realize that even though it's a part of the call, it's really not about how much we go to church. It's not about what committees we sit on, or what committees we're a part of, and how much money we give to the church, or our favorite charity. The goal of the call is to change the world around us by making the playing field fair for everyone. That is what Jesus accomplished on the cross. He lived a life in a relationship with the outcasts, with the downtrodden, with the overlooked, with the underappreciated, to reveal God does not just love those individuals who sit in the high places in life, but also cherishes and gets down deep with those of us who sit in the low places in life. And he does this to prove God's endless love for all of humanity. That is the goal I believe Paul is talking about in Philippians. Ask somebody once again, sitting next to you, are you pressing toward that call?
Are you pressing toward that call?
I was once asked by a student at SMU where I attended seminary why I chose to be a pastor. It was the first time someone had asked me that question who wasn't a Christian. It was the first time that I had to answer that question in a non-Christian response. Until that moment, it was an easy answer. I was called to do it. God chose me to do it. But I understood that that was religious talk. That someone who was not a part of our family would not understand what being called means. And so after a moment, I said to him, you know, my life was changed by what I learned about God. And I wanted to spend the rest of my life sharing that knowledge with the world. The knowledge that God cherishes relationship over riches and values all humanity. And this was revealed to me by the calling that Jesus had on his life. The world we live in profits from individuality. Profits from inequalities. We're told that success depends on how well we can pull our own bootstraps. And greed contributes to poverty around the world. We always find reason to blame the other. And it's all about what Marcus can obtain in life. But Paul urges us to consider a higher call, one that seeks to build relationships and spread love. a call to change the world around us by loving the stranger as we love ourselves, and loving God with all of our being. A heavenly call, Paul says, that makes the playing field fair for everyone and breaks down the walls that humanity created because God desires for us to be in unity. I ask you once more, will you all press toward that call?